everyone. Let's open our hymn books to page 635, and I'd like you all to please stand as we sing our Star Spangled Banner. Praise the power that has preserved us. And that's the one of the things that we really need to consider. What has kept us a country? Where do we give that honor to? And are we serving him in the way we should serve him? Then we're going to go to 634, and we're going to go sing My Country, 'Tis of Thee.
Thank you.
your books. We're going to kind of stay in the same section. We're going to go to 6:30, and we're going to sing America the Beautiful. But it's Amazing Grace, my chains are gone. And where do we get real freedom? We don't get real freedom in our country. It's wonderful we live in a country where we get some freedom. But the real freedom, no matter where you are, comes from knowing Jesus and having him release you from the chains of sin. Give me a second to breathe.
Thank you.
Am I missing something?
Specials.
Yeah, do we have any specials? I think that's enough.
Immanuel means God with us, at church and school, at home, at play. We can find God in everything. Don't believe me? Watch this.
Good morning, everybody. Oh, 3rd of July, 4th of July tomorrow. And what does that mean? It means freedom. It means our country. It means fireworks. We're going to look at fireworks tonight and watch all the beauty of the fireworks going off. I brought a firework with me. It's one of those ones that shoots the balls up and stuff like that there. I could light it off and shoot it. Why not? It might bounce off the ceiling, huh? Oh, okay. So you put a firework outside so it can go up and light up and shine for everybody to see. You don't put it inside of a building, right? You know, that reminds me, what did Jesus say? Light and not to hide it under a bushel. What's that little kids' song? This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel? Oh, no. I'm going to let it shine. God made us to shine. Not to be hid. Just like fireworks are made to be outside so everybody can see them. You can see some fireworks for miles and miles and miles. You can see them going off. Not inside. It's not safe to shoot them off inside. It's not safe to even have our light, our life. It's not safe for us to put it inside and hide it. Because we will shrivel and die. Because we're not showing and sharing this little light of mine. If you watch fireworks, remember, you're an example. Show it. Let's pray. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for giving us an example. Thank you for the beauty and the freedoms we have. Help us to shine for you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So here's your challenge for the week. Search for God in everything. You'll be amazed where you'll find Him.
Be dismissed for Children's Church. And we... I think Billy's got it ready for us to do our pledges. I think are you ready, Billy? Okay. Let's go ahead and stand and let's do the pledges there. Okay? Pledge of allegiance to the flag. Salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. Then to the Christian flag. Salute. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands. One brotherhood, uniting all Christians in service and in love. And then to the Bible. Salute. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Thank you. You may be seated. It is the 4th of July weekend, and we are celebrating the freedoms that we have. Freedom comes in several different forms, or seemingly does. If you'll turn in your Bible to Galatians, the 5th chapter. Brother Tom, in the opening for Sunday school, read a passage, and we're going to look back at it this morning. Okay, Galatians chapter 5. I'm going to read the first verse, and then I'm going to skip forward to the 13th verse. First verse. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be tangled again with the yoke of bondage. And skip down to verse 13. For if you, brethren, have been called to liberty, only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in this one word, even this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for love. Excuse me. You know our hearts, Lord. You know our desire to serve you. Thank you for the freedom that this world can't give us. Thank you for the freedom that comes through the blood of your Son. Thank you for giving us the freedoms that we have. Bless this word, everything we say and do. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Over two centuries ago, a group of men gathered together in Philadelphia, and they put their names, they endorsed the writing, the words of Thomas Jefferson, that started one of the largest political revolutions in human history. Words that still stir the feelings in people who seek and who value freedom. The words, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Freedom is an ideal that we can find in every age. But where do we seek it? How do we exercise freedom? So today I want to look at three forms that freedom come in, three forms that our quest for liberty take. And the first one Some people search for freedom. They seek freedom by force. The people that want freedom for themselves also often seek it by forcing it. What they want, they take. They don't respect a person. They don't respect property. Their sole intent is to satisfy what they want, their own lusts, whatever that is. And the philosophy behind that quest is that might makes right. If I have the power, that makes me right. It's a philosophy of the bully who demands that others give in to his wishes. He uses verbal force or threats, if possible, but is not opposed to using violence or physical force if it becomes necessary, because he has the right. He has the freedom because he has the power. But force doesn't really give us freedom. When people get on top of the game, on top of the ladder, by force, they become victims twice over. Victims of two forces that they really don't have any protection from. The one being the lust for more power. Those that have gotten to the top still want more and are not satisfied because there's got to be something more out there. They just can't find it. The other fear is that those below them, those that they trampled on to achieve their freedom, may come to overthrow them. They become the captors of the bully. Jesus said, "All that live by the sword shall die by the sword." There was a little girl one time that had a bag of marbles. Her brother had a bag of candy. Well, the brother wanted the marbles and the girl wanted the candy, so they said, "Well, I'll trade you my bag of marbles for your bag of candy." So the girl gave the entire bag of candy to the boy, or the bag of marbles, excuse me, to the boy. And the boy thought, "You know what? My sister doesn't know how much candy's in this bag. If I keep back some of this candy, I'll get all the marbles and have some candy still." So he traded. Well, the girl was satisfied. She traded the bag of marbles for candy, and she got her candy. The boy could not sleep that night. What if she kept some of those marbles? What if I didn't get all the marbles? He didn't have freedom because somebody else may have done what he did to come out on top. And so he didn't have the freedom. It's like in the old West, the fastest gun could never rest because somebody always wanted to kill him to become the fastest gun in the West. Or what about the team that brags, "We're number one"? Everybody wants to beat them. They can never rest because everybody is out to get that team. The exercise of raw force inspires its victims to yearn for true freedom. English officials back in 1667 imprisoned William Penn. They were trying to get him to give up his Quaker views. But he wrote, "The jail will be my grave before I'll ever change one jot. The Tower is the worst argument for those to use against me. For whoever may be right or wrong, those who use force can never be right." Doesn't matter whether you're right or wrong. If you use force to try to force your way, you are wrong. So freedom is not found in force. Might does not make right. But the second is the one that most people seek freedom through. Most people seek freedom through law. Judges, the book of Judges says, "Civilized society cannot exist where each does what's right in their own eyes. Where each one's personal whim or personal force guides social conduct, is not freedom. But yet, human history, over and over throughout all of human history, we see people trying to set up society, trying to set up by using law. Sometimes it may seem like it's the law of the jungle, but we're using laws and rules to try and set up a functioning society. The Declaration of Independence may be the world's most well-known example of this. The U.S. Constitution, the Bill of Rights, they're the one states what is felt and the other assumes. The law of nature and of nature's God entitle people to be equal. All people are created to be equal. And so it's the government's sole purpose is to secure these rights for people. But the government that secures its lawful powers through the, as the Declaration points out, the Constitution, the consent of the governed, they're looking to the source being the supreme judge of the world. They rely on protection from the divine providence. They pledge to each other their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor. The Constitution rests on the premise that the government's powers are dangerous when they're concentrated. So it distributes the powers. We all know how the legislative branch has the power to make law. The executive branch has the power to administer them. The judicial branch has the power to interpret them. The Bill of Rights says that there's certain rights that are beyond government's power. And you see the philosophy behind this whole setup, behind the Declaration, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the whole philosophy behind that is not might makes right, but right makes might. That is that right laws are a beneficial force, and it's essential to our peace of mind. It's essential to being able to get along with each other. It's essential to having peace that we have these laws. But law is a limited freedom at best. It marks the boundaries that we can live within. It's seen most of the time as the negative, thou shalt not. And for it to work, it needs to be applied equally to everybody. But that means that we have to have officials that administer it equally. That doesn't necessarily always work very well, does it? It never has. We are not free to obey the laws we like and ignore the rest of them. We have to obey all of them. And everyone that seeks to find freedom under the law, whether it's the Galatians that Paul was writing to, where he was contrasting the gospel of freedom, versus the freedom that was supposed to be found in law. And he talked about the law as being the tutor that would teach us about and take us to the real source of freedom. Sometimes we desire more freedom than what the law can give us. It's kind of like that old song, remember, don't fence me in. I just want to be free to roam, and we just want to be free from these laws. And however essential good laws are to society, even if they're applied equally and have leadership that applies for it, law cannot give us the full freedom that we so desire. It can give us a structure in which we live in. And we are very thankful that in America we have that structure that gives us that limited freedom. But let's not stop at that limited freedom. Let's not stop at this fence. Thou shalt not. Because it's only pointing us to the true freedom. The true freedom that can be found in the grace that is available through faith and that shows itself through love. We know from the Bible that freedom is available to anyone who believes in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's the theme of Galatians. It was written in the heat of the controversy between the ones that believed in the grace of God and those that were trying to say that's not enough. You have to also follow this law, the Judaizers. That controversy that was insisting that it's not enough. But Paul was writing to them that said the law was leading us. It's not what we need, but it was leading us to Jesus. And it's Jesus that can free us from the law's tyranny. It's Jesus that can free us and give us the Spirit so that we can voluntarily do what the law asks us. See, if we're forced to do what the law says, we're not free. We're only doing what we have to. But if we're free and we choose to follow the law, then we're truly free. Spiritual freedom can exist even when the human law strangles. Folks, Paul was in prison. No freedom. I mean, he is locked up. He gets his food when they say. He stands up when they say. He does what he does when they say. And yet he was able to write to us in Philippians, I have learned in whatever state I am in, therewith to be content. He was locked up and was freer than most people today. He was freer than Emperor Nemo that was bonded and in bondage between his own ego drives and the fear of his enemies. Paul was free. There was a lady, Madame Guyon, that was imprisoned by Louis XIV. For 10 years, she wrote this. You may recognize part of it. My cage confines me around. Abroad I cannot fly. But though my wing is closely bound, my heart's at liberty. My prison bars cannot control the flight, the freedom of the soul. Stone walls do not a prison make, nor iron bars a cage. Minds innocent and guilt take these for a heritage. When I am free within my heart and in my soul am free, angels alone that soar above enjoy such liberty. Prison bars do not define our liberty. Laws do not define our liberty. Love is the companion to that faith that brings us to Jesus. Jesus tells us, or John does, he records this for us, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out freedom. Where there's no fear. That is perfect freedom. Love is what fulfills what the law can only dream of. Love is what the law is pointing to, if we'll just look at it. The ideal which the best of the laws are looking for. That the observation of those negative boundaries can only be attained by the positive command of love. Law says, thou shalt not. What does love say? Love thy neighbor as thyself. If the Son of God makes you free, folks, you are truly free. And from that time on, you'll never be the same. If you want freedom, seek it where you can find it. It's not going to be found in force. It doesn't matter how strong you are. It's not going to be found in the law, no matter how good it is. As our praise team comes up, the only place that you can find true freedom is in faith in Jesus Christ, in the love that's embodied in His actions. Where are you looking for your freedom? Where are you seeking to find it? Will you look in Jesus? Will you turn to Him? He'll give you the freedom. He'll make it available. As we sing 321, as we stand, He is waiting for us. He's waiting to give you freedom. Don't be tied down any longer. Turn to that freedom as we sing. Debbie plays. Maybe there's a time in your past that you did open the door to Jesus. You asked Him to come in, and He did come in. But you've been trying to take care of things. You've been trying to figure it out. You've tried to set up some laws and rules in your life so that you could live by them. And you haven't found the freedom that you had one time. You're suffering. He's waiting for you once again to come to Him, to put Him back as Lord of your life. Will you do that? If you've never done it, now's the time. Come. Let Him be Lord. Be Lord again as we sing.
If you'll take one step toward the Savior, my friend, you'll
other word.